Hello, everybody, and thank you for connecting to our webinar for standard drafts of this afternoon. And this afternoon, we will be talking, or we will show you a real-life edit of a CENELEC deliverable. So the editors are very patient to show you in detail what they're working on every day. My name is Elsa, and I will be moderating the webinar in the background. As usual, all attendees are muted during the presentations, but I invite you to use the Q&A panel to submit your questions, should you have any. And then the speakers will have a look at your questions after the presentations. The webinar has been recorded, so you will receive the recording in your inbox later today, as well as the presentation. And then the Q&A report will be made available later on. Should you be on Twitter or X, as we call it today, please feel free to tweet about the topic with the hashtag training for standards. So without further ado, I think I can give the floor to my colleagues, Amy and Claire, who will show you a live edit of a CENELEC deliverable. So please, Claire and Amy, the floor is yours.
Thanks, Els. Good afternoon, everybody. Yes, we're going to jump into looking at a CENELEC document today. The purpose of our live edit is to show you what the deliverable should look like when it comes into us, what we do with it. We're going to hopefully correct any misconceptions you might have about the documents and also troubleshoot some problems together.
Yes, exactly. So really go into depth today. So you're probably sick of hearing us talk about the templates, but it's important to understand have to start with the CENELEC template. And this is found on the CENELEC boss on the lovely drafting page that contains all of the drafting guidance as well. We do give you the link, but just to refresh your memory of where that is, if you go to the CENELEC boss, you're going to go over to reference materials and then forms and templates on the left-hand side. And then underneath technical work, if you give that a click, you have all these links. And it's right here, the CENELEC simple template for drafting standards. So you have the French and German versions too. These are just Word document downloads. And you also have a quick start guide. So if you need some help getting started with that template, this should be your first port of call. But we ask that you use it for all new work and all revisions. So regardless of what it is you're doing, you have to use that template. And if you're not sure if a revision is in the template, you can reach out to us and ask, but it's worth just copy pasting it in as you go through and edit the draft yourself.
In the end, it'll cut down on a lot of time for everybody.
Exactly. It's all about efficiency.
Indeed. All right, everybody. So let's dive in and let's take a look at a CENELEC deliverable.
Absolutely. So first thing that the editors usually do, we have our network, which looks like this. So today we're going to be editing an inquiry text. So we usually call this 41E, and then STF is the version that we edit. This is a copy of the STW, which is what you submit to us. So we just make a copy. That way we always have
the original record, the one that you've provided to us.
Exactly. So this is what we're going to be working in today. So we open it up and we make it big. Now, a few things to note. First of all, this is lovely. But we need to first of all check the database for a few things before we even get started. And then we need to set up our editing environment as well.
Shall we do that first? Shall we have a look at the database?
Absolutely. So usually we take the work item, we search for it, and then we have this screen that you should be able to see.
So this is just a little bit of inside information from our side, what our database looks like, and the different elements of the metadata that we check against the document you've provided to us.
Exactly. And all of this information is populated from what you submit on the submission interface as well. So this is what happens with all of that information. So as we can see at the top left, we have your work item number. This is fictitious. We have created this for the purpose of today's webinar. So none of this information is real. So we have our fictitious work item. We have our standard reference as well. We can see it's an inquiry. It's PREN. We then have the track that it's on, the technical body. So for today, it's a CENELEC TC edit. It spells out edit. Our drafting body is obviously CCMC. As is the secretariat. The secretary are your editors.
Us
as the editors. And our CCMC contact point. So this is the person, the non-editor person within CCMC. We might refer to them as a technical PM. And this today, We've just put our manager's name in there, Gonzalo, just to put some information there for you. But what we're going to pay attention to on this screen is at first the title. This is quite an important thing that we check first.
It is. So we're going to whip back to our Word document and we're going to have a look and see, do they match?
Exactly.
Let's have a look here. So we have live edit of a standard, inquiry and formal vote, editing and processes. So we
Exactly.
go back to our database. We have live edit of a standard, inquiry and formal vote, in-depth editing steps and processes. So we can see the last element of the title doesn't not match. So
Exactly. So we have something to change. Now, what we usually do is we take the title that you provide to us here. And we input that into our database because we consider that this title in the document is the most up-to-date version. That's why it's very important that you make sure you've got the correct title in your Word document, even if you have nothing else on the title page as well.
indeed.
It's entirely possible that if you're starting new work, you won't have a reference. This is okay.
That's okay.
You
We can
can rule
help
this
you with
out.
that.
Exactly. Because the reference is allocated when you submit the text to us and it's allocated to an editor. So you might not have it at all. If you have a revision, however, you just use the previous reference and keep that in. But all of this information, the secretariat, the date, the TC, if you don't have it or you're not sure, don't worry about it. We can put that in for you. Also, a note on the French and German titles. You might not have those. That's okay again. We do send all of our inquiries to translation with very rare exceptions. So we can always provide these. If you do have them, pop them in for information. It's not a problem either.
Okay, before we go forward, Amy, there's a couple of things we need to do to the document to make sure it's in
Yes.
the best place it can be, the clearest place it can be for editing. So,
Exactly.
first of all, we're going to put on our paragraph marking.
Yes.
This might look messy if you're not used to writing in Word when this is turned on, but it is quite essential and makes things a lot easier.
Exactly. For example, you can see on the title page, if we turn these off, this is down here. It's right in the middle of the page. We don't know what's making this be in the middle of the page. So if we pop our paragraph markers on, we can see that there are many hard returns that are aligning this. This is important for us to see because we want everything to be spaced out in the correct way. So while this looks good, it might cause us some problems. So it's always good to be able to see. So that's the first thing that we need to do. Now, the second thing that we need to be able to see is our styling as well. Right now, we can't see what this is styled as. So we need to do two things. First of all, we need to open up the styling pane, which is different to the styling palette. So we're going to go to View across the top. And then on the left-hand side, the very far left, we've got this draft view, which is what we're going to go into. If you'd like keyboard shortcuts over this, you can do Control, Alt, and N, and that will give you the same view. And as we can see right here, we've got this styling pane on the left-hand side that just tells us how this is styled.
But Amy, sometimes when I open a document, I don't always see that. Well, that styling pane is not appearing.
Right.
Maybe you can run through how to make this appear if it's not there.
Of course, it's entirely possible, especially if you've never done this before. So we might see that it's like this and you've got nothing. So you'll go to File on the far left at the very top, and then you'll go all the way down here to Options, and this will give you a pop-up box. We're going to ignore this and go straight to Advanced, and then scroll down about halfway until you see Display right here. Now you can see I've just made this pane very small and it's reflected right here in this box beside Style Area Pane Width in Draft and Outline Views. And it's that Style Area pane that we want to make bigger. So you can put any number in here, but we like 2.5 centimeters. That usually gives us enough space for what we need. And as you can see, it pops back up. So that's the second thing. The next thing we need to do is show our style palette as well. So you're going to go to the Home tab, we go to Styles, and there's this tiny little drop-down arrow right here. You click that, you get a funky little box that you can move around the screen, you can attach it there, you can have it tiny, you can resize it. Oops. It's very versatile.
And that will show you all the different styles.
Exactly. This is more or less how the editors have it set up as well. Ours looks a tiny little bit different, but this is how you'll see it. And we recommend that you set everything up like this as well. Just makes things a bit more efficient. So now that that is done, we've taken a look at the title. We've maybe put your reference in here if we've needed to. We can start actually looking at the
We can.
text.
All right, let's go.
Cool.
So first of all, I think what every editor does is fix the headers and the footers. Again, if your reference isn't in here, we will quite simply just type that in for you with the correct year. And of course, we don't really want it in red. We're going to put it in black. Exactly. And if there's any random things like this, we just delete as well. And we're going to have to do that on both sides because the style is that it's alternate pages with the left and right
Yes.
margins.
And what we will say about the headers and footers is we've set this up for you in the template so that it's automatic. So whatever you change here and on page two will reflect in the rest of the document. So don't mess with any of these checkboxes. Don't link anything to previous. Just leave it as it is and it will work perfectly. If it's not working, you get in touch with us and we can try and see why. So we're going to ignore the table of contents for the minute. That's something that we're going to take a look at towards the end. And the first thing that we look at is the European forward. Now, this is
This
an
looks like quite a long forward, Amy, for an
it
inquiry.
certainly
I think
does.
we've got some paragraphs in here that might not need to be in here.
Yeah,
Definitely the
for
second
sure.
paragraph, I think we can delete that straight away. The reason why we can delete that is because that standard template paragraph only belongs in publication texts. So
Exactly.
at this stage, it's gone.
Yeah,
Doesn't need to be there.
exactly.
Then we can start filling in what is specific to this text. So we can put in our reference number again, our year, and we can fix the font color. And then we can modify the second paragraph to show where the text is at. So we want to pop that to the inquiry.
Exactly. And if you have any other type of deliverable, you just delete which ones you don't need. But today we have a lovely inquiry draft and we make it black as well. Now, this table, this is really for the publication, but because it's inquiry and the same at formal vote, the dates are only proposed. So when we get to publication stage, we do change this to fixed and we put these dates
We
in
put the exact
as well.
dates in,
Yeah.
yes.
But this just needs to be in there so that the members, when they vote, they know this is roughly the right track that it should be on, basically. So leave this in there. This is completely fine. This is a new work that we've done for today's webinar. So we don't have any superseding information or anything like that. So we can delete this. And because we don't supersede anything, obviously we have no technical changes because we can't change something that doesn't exist. So we can delete this too.
Gone.
Now, this is specific to CENELEC. This document is read in conjunction with EN, whichever. In our case, it's not applicable, so we can delete this as well. But if you do have something that needs to be read in conjunction with, you just fill out the correct reference. Now, this is quite interesting. This is if your document is harmonized, you have a few different options. So you can leave everything in if you have an annex Z said, if it's harmonized. If it's just under a standardization request, you can simply delete this part and just leave
Just
this
have that
sentence.
sentence that mentions the actual
Exactly.
request. Yeah.
Now, in our example, we do have an example of an annex Z said. So we should really leave this in, but because our annex Z said is empty, it's just for your information, we're going to go ahead and delete that too. Now, the rest of this is also for publication too. So we are going to delete the list of countries and the feedback
Yes,
as well.
not necessary at the moment. It's
Exactly.
better to have a nice clean text.
Yeah. So this is what your foreword should look like. It's okay if you don't have the reference, but at the very least, you should know your technical committee. You should pop that in there, title of your technical committee, and the secretariat that holds it. And we've just pulled this from our database screen. You can
So
see.
if it's not correct, rather make sure it is correct in the document you provide to us. If there's a discrepancy between what's in our database and what's in the text, same as with the title, we will take what is in the Word document that you provide us and update our database.
Exactly. So now that our foreword is beautiful and perfect and has all the right information in, we can go ahead and take a look at the next component, which is our introduction in this
Introduction,
case.
yeah. Introductions aren't always in documents. They are allowed to be. They are only informative. But if you have patent rights attached to your text, then you definitely do need an introduction. So we have a
Exactly.
couple of template paragraphs that need to be included in there. We've just included this in our example just to let you know about that. But there are no patents, of course, attached to our document because it's fictitious.
Exactly. So we can go ahead and delete those. But we still have this portion of text right here because we wanted to give some extra context that doesn't really fit in the scope, but just gives a little bit of background about our standard. And that goes in the introduction. It doesn't fit in the foreword, it doesn't fit in the scope, it's contextual, so introduction is perfect.
Oh, but Amy, hang on. I can see in the first sentence it says has to follow the rules of the internal regulations, part three. That doesn't really read as just informative.
It does not. That actually reads as a requirement, which is not allowed in the introduction. So we have to edit this, we have to redraft it. If I looked at this, I would say simply that the CENELEC deliverable, the editing of a CENELEC deliverable follows the rules.
I think that's a good suggestion, Amy. Let's do that. And
Perfect.
we just add an S,
Nice.
and our sentence makes sense.
Perfect. So this is something that the editors do quite a lot. We take a look at different sentences and we see if they need to be reformulated. So I'm happy with this, Claire, if you are.
I think so. Let's move
Cool.
on.
Excellent. So now we have the scope. So the scope always has to be clause one. Nothing else can be clause one, only the scope. And it is an obligatory element and has to contain only statements of fact. So a quick scan over of this already
We
shows
have
a
a bit
few
of a problematic
problems.
scope, I think.
We
Yeah.
do
So
indeed.
no, that means no requirements,
Yep.
no recommendations, and no permissions. So
Exactly.
if we see the words shall, should, or may, we are going to have to do something about it.
Exactly. And we have two shall and one should. So
Okay.
we need to redraft these out. Now, sometimes it is as simple as changing it to the editing steps outlined in this European standard are carried out by any of the editors. That's
I think
okay
that's
now.
okay.
Yeah. And then I suppose the same thing here, Claire. Do you agree? Editing is carried out.
Editing is, yes, let's do that.
Cool.
That makes sense.
And then this
Informative.
should. So the editor of this document, we could say, shows how to.
There we go.
So that is nice and simple. Nice and simple
Now the scope
fixes.
is informative.
It is. But we still have some problems here because we are referring to this European standard. And actually, IR3 says now we have to refer to this document just so that we can have some flexibility if we want to change the track that a document is on later. Maybe you want to change this to a technical specification. You don't have to go through and change everything to this technical specification. So we're just going to change that to this document.
And we've got another one, next line that will also become this document,
Yes.
and another one.
Right here. There we go. So that was just a quick copy and paste all the way through. And we'll check the whole text for that. If we see it's present here, usually it's present throughout the whole text.
That's just to let you know that we do this and why we do it.
Exactly. Exactly. This also means that the IR3 reference right here is no longer normative. Previously it was, now it's not. And this is how it should be. It shouldn't be normative in the scope. So I think we can move on to clause two, if you're happy with that.
Clause two. Okay, at the start of clause two, we have some template text that should be there. Looking at this text, did you write this, Amy?
I
Did
certainly
you?
did because
Okay.
sometimes we see drafters don't follow the boilerplate text that's given in the template and in IR3. So sometimes they draft what they feel applies better to their situation. But the boilerplate text is from IR3, so you have to follow it.
That's what we have to use.
Exactly.
So we are going to have to go into the IR3.
Exactly.
Amy will just take you there now.
So we can search for CENELEC IR3.
Just in Google, and that should come up straight away.
It does come up with the CEN boss at first as the first reference, but you saw I searched for the CENELEC IR3. They are exactly the same. It's the same document. I'm sure everyone knows that by now, though. And we've done this many, many times. It's a frequent, we're frequent visitors to this clause, let's say. But 15.5.2 gives you two options for introductory wording. So if you have no normative references, you have an option. In our case, we have some. So we're going to take this text, copy,
And go back to our document.
Exactly. Now, a little trick for you. If you highlight all of the text you want to replace, but you leave out the full stop, when you hit keep text only when you do paste, it will paste it in the correct style as well.
That's important.
Yes, that's very important. That can save you a lot of time and it can save you a lot of formatting and a lot of styling time as well. It's a hack that I use every single document that I edit, I think, actually. So this is now the correct boilerplate text. If we see anything else, we do modify it. So now we take a look at every single reference that we have, and we make sure that they're actually normative in the text.
Yes, so we've seen with the first one, the internal regulations part three, that was already mentioned in the scope. So now we're going to have to do a little search using our navigation pane on the left-hand side of our screen
Yes.
and see whether it's mentioned anywhere else in the text in terms of a requirement. Because otherwise, it's
Exactly.
not allowed to stay in clause two.
Exactly. So at a glance, we can see, okay, it's in the introduction, the scope, and clause two. So this is not normative. So we can ignore this. But interesting that we see something in the main body. So we can be a little bit lazy in the beginning and we can take a look at our results. And maybe if we're lucky, there's a shall be according to internal regulations.
I don't see a
Let's see.
shell there.
No, we are unfortunately not lucky today. So we have to go and do a little bit more digging. So we can read this. So we have our first mistake we need to edit out later on. And we see drafting specifically is covered by the internal regulations part three. That doesn't seem normative to me,
No,
though.
I don't think so at all. That's just an informative sentence. So no luck there.
And the second result that we have, drafting is difficult and the IR3 can be very vague. That's a statement of fact.
It
That's
is.
not normative.
Okay, well, unfortunately, that IR3 referencing clause two has to be removed.
Exactly. So very simply, what we do is we cut it, we do Control X, we go down to our bibliography. And we do need to edit this bibliography. It's not laid out well,
No.
but just so that we can keep track, we just paste
We
it
just
in.
pop it there for now and we will deal with the bibliography later.
Exactly. Yeah, perfect. Now we do that if there's one reference or if there's 50, we have to check every single one. So it's worth just making sure while you're drafting that those normative references are actually attached to requirements. So now we have these two, which are obviously not real references, but this is just to show you some of the layout problems that we hit that can be quite time-consuming if it's with every single reference, and just how to avoid them. So,
So, first of all, we don't want any tabs. So, we're going to get rid of that tab there.
yeah.
And we're going to put in just a comma and a space. That's all it needs to be. I can see that the title is italicized. So, that's
Yes.
a good thing. And now that first reference looks okay to me.
Exactly. And we can see on our style palette at a glance, it's styled correctly as well.
Great.
But if we go into our draft view, we can see right here, it's also ref norm. It's styled correctly, so we're good.
Okay, on to the next one. We do have a year in there, that's fine. But then I see we have a little space between the plus symbol. That space can't be there. We need to get rid of both of those, even if you think it might look nicer. Unfortunately, we need that reference altogether because of the
Exactly.
tools that we use to process the document and to look things up.
Yes.
We don't need any spaces there, basically.
Exactly, because it treats each portion of text separated by a space as a separate portion of text. So it kind of panics a little bit and tells us that there's a problem because it can't find the reference X or the reference plus. But of course, that doesn't exist. That's silly.
Exactly. All right. And what else we do? You can see what I'm doing here is just fixing the rest of the small things up. We're getting rid of our tab, I think we had there. We're adding in
Yes.
our comma. We're adding a year to the amendment. That's really important. And
Exactly.
we're italicizing our title.
Exactly. So this is how they should be laid out. Obviously, if you don't have a date for your standard, you just remove the date and the colon and have the comma straight afterwards. But please make sure that you lay it out like this. The reason being, when we run our processes, if it's not laid out like this, we can't check different things that would otherwise be quite time consuming for us to check. So one of our processes checks, for example, the standard title against what we have in our database. And then that saves us having to go into the database one by one and check everything. We can see at a glance if something's changed, if something's correct, incorrect, that kind of thing. Also, if standards are open, closed, withdrawn, published, not published. So it's really important that these are laid out properly, especially if you have a huge number of them.
Yes.
So this now looks good, I
Yep.
think.
Let's go to clause three. Clause three is
Yes.
always terms and definitions.
Absolutely.
And it always has these first two sentences, first sentence that you see here. It can be, of course, that you don't have any terms and definitions. And then, similar to clause two, you have to
Yes.
use the template text from the internal regulations part three and
Yes.
put in the correct sentence that says this.
Exactly.
These two references to the international databases and the sentence preceding, this is not mandatory. You don't have to put this in, but you're welcome to. If it's in there, we will leave it there.
Yeah, we don't delete this systematically. So, onto the terms and definitions themselves. We've tried to show you some of the problems that we meet regularly. So with the first one, the biggest problem that we see is these soft returns. So this is just a little bent arrow, basically. Why is this so much of a problem? It looks fairly harmless. Well, this basically says that you need to treat any line of text underneath as though it's the same line of text. So it will look at 3.1 and style and consider it to be like a sentence, a full sentence. And the
Maybe we
same
can
thing with
jump into the
this.
draft view, which shows that,
Yes, so if
I
I move the
think.
palette out of the way, we can quite clearly see this is styled as term number. And if I click it right here, it's highlighting the whole thing because it's treating it as one unified portion of text, basically. So if I try to style this style part as term, which it should be, it styles
It's
the whole
going to
thing.
style everything as term.
Exactly,
So what we
which.
need to do now is really to separate out these elements. And you do that simply by deleting that little soft return and making it a hard return. And
Exactly.
then we can go through and style everything properly how it
Yes.
should be.
So this should be term, that's already correct. This should be term number or term num. And then this one is definition. And you see how simple it is for me to style. It's point and click. It's really, really easy. We can get rid of that paragraph marker right there. So that's all correctly styled now.
But you can imagine, of course, if you have a lot of terms and definitions
Of
that all
course.
need this kind of detailed styling, it takes a long, long time.
Exactly. So I'm just fixing the font there. For some reason, it's in Cambria. And it should be Arial. So that's all correctly styled now with our nice hard returns, no soft returns. The next problem that I can see is the article. So we don't want these to start with any an or the. We simply get rid of it. And that means we do read your definitions carefully because these are technical elements, and at publication stage, we can't change anything about them. So you really need to make sure you read these carefully. And then, of course, the source, we've taken this from the CENELEC boss to give you an example. This is part of the definition itself. So now we can take a look at 3.2. There's many problems with this one, but no soft returns, which is good.
Okay.
So we can go right ahead and start with this. So this is the term. This should always be lowercase unless you are defining something like European Union, which is always written with capitals, of course. Then we want no punctuation at the end. So we can do the same with that admitted term. If you want a bigger deep dive into terms and definitions, you can always take a look at our webinar that we did on IR3, where we gave some very fun examples of terms and definitions, and we had a lovely time. So take a look at that.
This is also quite long, Amy. I think something needs to change here, and we have a few sentences, which is not
Definitely.
okay. So we should
Absolutely.
not have any full stops in our definitions.
No.
The definition needs to be able to replace the term. That's
Yes.
the basic rule for drafting definitions.
Exactly.
So we're going to get rid
Exactly.
of the article, and then we're going to have a read through. The first sentence was indeed the
Yes.
definition. And we can
Exactly.
see that the other two sentences are more additional information, let's say. So they properly belong in the text still, but as a note to entry.
Exactly. So very simply, we're just going to copy and paste our note to entry right there. We're going to style this as note as well. That's note. And then obviously we're going to fix our numbering as well and fix our font.
Seems to change.
It does. If you do have this problem and it's systematic, do let us
Let
know.
us
This is
know.
something we can fix
Yeah.
as well. So this looks okay. It's worth noting that notes to entry can contain shall, should, and may for requirements, recommendations, and permissions. But body text notes, so notes in clause four onwards, cannot contain those elements. It's a bit of a strange rule, but it's there. That's what we have to
Bye
abide by.
bye.
Exactly. All right. So clause four abbreviations, you can put this into clause three if you want to. In which case, you'd use a separate heading here for terms and definitions. These would then become 3.1.1, 3.1.2, and so on. And this would be 3.2. In our case, we've left it as clause four. For tables where it's laid out like this, and we don't want to see the borders, very handy trick for all of you. You can pop this in a table. Obviously, the borders are hidden. You can see here, no border. But why can we still see the lines? It's interesting. If we go to home and this paragraph part here, all the way down here, we've got this handy feature called View Table Grid Lines. And this will show these dotted lines, but they don't show up in the PDF or if you print this out. This is just to say, hey, there's a table right here.
Maybe we
Be
can
aware of
show
it.
it without the grid lines, because I think
Yes.
alongside the having the paragraph markers turned on, this is a really important thing to
Exactly.
do while you're editing or writing the text. Sorry.
Yes. So we can see
Yeah.
how clean it looks, but if we hover over, we still have a table, but maybe we have more cells down here. I don't know. So that is a really good thing to keep on. And I think most of the editors keep this turned on permanently.
Yep.
It looks strange if we don't have this on, actually, for me. So that's all great. That's all good. We can now move on to actually drafting a European standard or clause five. So we mentioned that we turn this European standard into this document. Now, this is where we apply our language skills, because actually, if we turn this to document, it doesn't make any sense,
No.
right? So we leave this as at European standard or drafting European standard. This is completely fine. But then if we start reading in depth, this chapter,
That doesn't sound right. That's not the terminology we use.
it is not. We refer to parts of the document as clauses. So this clause defines the steps CCMC editors take to ensure a clean, polished deliverable. That's
That's
was it a...
not really that's a bit too familiar, I think.
It certainly is. So we simply change that to that is and keep it nice and professional. That is great to read and easy for translations.
Translation is, it sounds kind of cool, but it's not correct.
Exactly.
So we do always correct.
Oh. If we can type translators, there we go. To translate into the three official languages, we've got a delightful reference to our figure one right there. Well-drafted standard on CCMC editors. And then we've got something funky happening at the end there with our punctuation.
Catastrophe stops.
We fix that. So this now looks good. So you can see we do read in depth. So now we've got a problem with the figure title.
Yes, so figure titles shouldn't contain any colons. So we're going to get rid of the colon there, and they do contain a
M
dash,
dash,
an M
yes.
dash. Haha. The M dash is the longest dash you're going to find. So we go
Exactly.
up to our insert tab along the top, and then all the way to the right to symbol. And usually it's up there in one of the most
Yes.
used symbols. And we just click
Yes.
on it, and then that will insert there.
Exactly. And this is the case for table titles as well. So, your figure titles and table titles, simply your figure or table space. M dash space and then the rest. If you have the rest, you don't need the rest, but if you do. So this is really, really nice. We're really happy with this.
That looks quite neat. But Amy, I can see with them we've got 5.1. That means that everything in the above, the figure and the first two paragraphs, are actually kind of hanging in the air. They're really difficult to refer to. So what we need to do
Yes.
is add in another level heading. So I'm going to go up here and type in general. And then we're going to make this the same style as this one down here. And
Yes.
how I'm going to do that is I'm going to go back to my home tab and I'm going to go format painter and I'm going to click on general and then we go. That's just another little trick that we use. You can
Yes.
get into trouble sometimes if we don't cover the paragraph markers correctly, but that
Yes.
isn't it is an option.
Exactly. Just a little trick to show you both ways. If you don't feel comfortable with that, your styling
Just do your
palette is
styles.
right there for
Yes.
you. So now that we've resolved our hanging paragraph, we can start checking this. Now, at first glance, it looks great, but we have a bit of a problem in that this list doesn't look quite right, and it's not so clear what the level should be. So I think this probably should be on the same level as this. So again, we can maybe do our format painter. Whoops. Do our format painter and apply it to that. And it didn't work. It doesn't always work. Sometimes we have to gently convince it. It doesn't want to work. Wonderful. It's supposed to be right there, but for some reason our style doesn't want to work. That's okay.
So
We can work with it.
your first point should be bullet point should be a level one.
Yes. We can see it's styled correctly down here. So this is okay. We can
Maybe we
work with
have a
this.
little bug with the palette or
Exactly.
something.
It's entirely possible that happens, but please don't panic. Let your editor know and we can fix it. Now, with this, it's not so clear if this is all supposed to be on this level because we know the stage of a deliverable is inquiry or formal vote.
It's not really a technical specification or a
No.
technical report. So there's a question mark here, I guess. It doesn't really make
Exactly.
sense. So this kind of thing, we would get in touch with you to
Exactly.
find out what the intention was.
Absolutely. So we leave this as it is. We make a note, however, we make our notes, and then we get back to you later on. So we can leave this alone for now because it looks good. Obviously, the list ends with a full stop, as we do good grammar. So now I think this part is all okay. This
I think
looks
we can keep on going.
good. You might find that your headings do something funky. They jump in from time to time. We see this all the time, but our tools in-house that are slightly different to this, they can strong arm things into the right place. So just as long as we see it's heading two,
Yeah, as
we
long
don't
as
care.
it's styled correctly, it'll be okay.
Exactly. So this all looks completely fine, I think. Maybe we look at.
Oh, maybe not. Maybe not that second paragraph there. I'm
Yes.
reading the drafter of the European standard shall ensure that the text is styled and in the template before submission to CCMC. This
Yes.
sentence is really problematic. So first of
Yes.
all, we have a requirement being made on someone.
Yes.
When we're drafting standards, we want to concentrate on the who, on the what and the how,
Yes.
not on the who.
Exactly. Exactly. So we can offer some proposals on how to redraft this. And I think in this case, it's quite simply just we can take all of this and get rid.
Yeah, that would be a good solution, I think.
And simply just have ensure that the text, because anybody can ensure. The most important thing is that it is ensured,
That's right.
basically. Just ahead of it, though, I can see there's another big problem that we maybe can't fix right now, and that we'll need a bit more input from maybe some technical PM colleagues, from drafters, from TCs. And this is a normative reference to a national legislation. This is
It's
never
not possible.
allowed. It's not allowed in any circumstances. We do remove them systematically. I don't know what you would propose, Claire, but for me, this one, I would take this out, and I would put it in a note and then reword this slightly.
Yeah, I think that's a good proposal, Amy.
Okay.
I think we can make the sentence work without it. Correct
Yes.
styling is
Therefore, required
required
to
to
ensure.
ensure. There we go. So we're just
Perfect.
going to delete those couple of words
Yes.
and we can add in a note underneath.
Paste that, and then we go right to the beginning. We're going to add a note in there with a tab this time. That's one place we do want to see tabs, is after
Oh, I
notes.
think you do.
Remember that. And then we can
We
simply write
see it.
C, the relevant national legislation, for more information. Something like that. It's a statement of fact right now. We don't need to. We're not required to go anywhere or anything like that. It's just making note that this might exist, but the requirement is on the styling right now. If we do this, We will contact you, and we won't progress the text at all until we have your approval. If you're not happy with it, we offer for you to talk to the technical PM. We offer drafting guidance. We try to resolve
We'll
this.
work with you to find the best solution.
Exactly.
Yes.
And we have the same problem down here
Oh,
as
yeah.
well, just with a directive this time.
Yes. And first of all, we have CCMC must. Must is kind of a red flag for us as well.
Yes.
There are only very few circumstances that it's allowed to, the word is allowed to appear in a deliverable. And
Exactly.
the IR3 outlines what they are very clearly. But in this instance, we would change this to a shall.
Yes. Exactly.
Because we are expressing a requirement.
Yes.
But the important thing is here as well, we have a requirement to the EN ISO 17000 series. This is also not allowed.
Exactly. Because
What do we
this,
do, Amy?
well, this is, I believe, neutrality principle conformity assessment issues, which is outside of the scope of the editor's technical expertise. So we need to ideally speak to the technical PM about this and just see what the best way forward is. The quickest way to do this would be to just remove the requirement altogether and mention that this series exists. But any of the standards that fall under this series, it is an immediate stop to the production line just so that we can reassess this. So we can't do anything about it today. So we're going to take a note of this. We're going to contact our technical PM and we're going to contact you about this.
Okay, and similarly for the second sentence, we got a
Exactly.
requirement to a directive that's also not allowed.
Yes.
So we're going to do something there and get rid of that
Exactly.
requirement.
It's not so easy to reword this, though, I believe. I can't think of any way that we could reword this immediately. I would propose to simply just delete the whole thing. Or again, like we did up here, we can say see directive blah blah for additional information and just replicate the same thing. But again, we contact you and we let you know that that's the situation.
Yes.
So I think, given all this, I think we can move ahead to the next page, to the next
Okay, then we
clause,
next
forgive me.
clause, then we have
Yes.
our apparatus clause.
Yes,
Okay, and so
we
we've got
do.
a bit of different styling to talk about here. We have instead of level one, two, and three headings, we have P.
Yes, the delightful P heading.
Yes.
So P is basically a numbered paragraph. So P is for paragraph. And what this allows you to do is it allows you to have a clause reference here. So this is 531, but it won't give us an error, basically. And it also separates it out at a nice spacing as well. So this is how this should be laid out perfectly. We've given you the tools for successful drafting and editing. This is what the editors use every single day.
We certainly do.
And also the notes, worth noting, they don't need to be numbered because they're in technically
Separate
separate clauses.
numbered elements of the text. But our
Exactly.
numbers are a little bit wrong because we
Yes,
fixed
they
that
are.
hanging paragraph before. So we do need to go in and manually edit these ones
Exactly.
because they're not level headings. They don't automatically update.
Oops. Oh, exactly. And it's worth noting that if you have a load of these, it is a bit of extra work, but it's worth it in the end because this looks very
It
nice,
does look
I
nice.
think. So this is nice. So we can move on to clause six. Now we can see here maybe the drafters made a mistake or something. Maybe they didn't type it all the way, something like that. So all CENELEC deliverables. And obviously we want that in capitals because CENELEC is always written in capitals. It looks horrible when it is written lowercase nowadays. So all CENELEC deliverables are subject to the rules of the whole series of the IR3. This is all completely fine, but we do have another must. So we would change this to shall again.
Shall.
And we do let you know that that is the case as well.
Yes.
Now, the next problem is obviously our drafters love these numbered paragraphs, but these are headings and we can see them showing up on the left-hand side in our navigation pane. So what do we do here? Well, simply add our numbers in because we will lose them any second now when we apply the style
P
P2.
two.
There we go. And again, it wants to be in Cambria, which is wrong. So we're going to change that back to Arial. There we go. Now, there's another issue with this, and that's the delightful apostrophe
Yes, so
in
if we
this.
see apostrophes like this, we will delete them
Yes.
and we will correct the English for you.
Exactly.
So again, it's nice and professional.
Exactly. So in our note, I can see that we have another Exclamation point. So we remove things like that too.
Enthusiastic, but not so professional.
Exactly. We appreciate the enthusiasm, just maybe not here. So again, right here, this would be 6.2. We do exactly the same thing. And this time I'm going to be a little bit lazy and I'm going to take our format painter. And that did not work. That's all right. We're going to do the whole
The whole
thing.
thing.
There we go. And it still didn't work. You see, it doesn't always work for everybody, huh?
Which is why we really should use our style palette.
Exactly. Exactly. And this obviously, again, needs to be in Arial. There we go. So this now looks very, very nice,
Yep. That's
styling-wise.
good. I think we need to number our notes though, Amy.
We certainly do. So there's one, and there is two. Perfect. So now, after editing our standards package, this looks okay, this first list. However, we do need to apologize to many of you who we've told to stop using automatic numbering because we've discovered recently in our own template that we tell you to use all the time, it has automatic numbering and we didn't know. So we're very sorry
We
for
are
that.
very sorry.
We'll stop harassing you to not use
Yes.
automatic numbering because you don't have any control over it.
And what we will do is we'll get the template fixed.
Exactly. We're looking into it now. We're looking into why it's happening, and maybe we need to fiddle with the styles a little bit, but that's for us to worry about.
Yes.
In short, as long as it is styled correctly, we don't care, basically. So just ensure that you've got the correct styling. The point here was basically to highlight that if you have numbered lists like this, please don't use A lowercase here and then have this one as A uppercase. Because you can't really refer to AA very easily, but you can refer to A1 pretty easily. So make sure these are different. So you can see here we've got A, then we've got 1, and then we've got I. You can do it in any order that you want to, but just make sure that it is different. And this is all completely fine with the exception of that note. Does not need to be numbered.
No, because it's the only one.
Exactly.
And we just have some extra spaces over here that we're going to get rid of. And we should have a date there, I believe, too.
Exactly. So we're going to pretend that's 2019. Again, that's for us for tagging it up as well.
Yes.
So this will tell us, hey, Amy Jane, this doesn't really exist. This should be 2020. So we need to be able to see that. So now I think we can move on to what I call the nightmare of codes, because these do give us nightmares. And again, it is this tiny little soft return. It looks harmless. It is not
But it's a
harmless.
tiny horror.
It
It
is.
is.
It absolutely is.
And so time consuming.
Exactly. So this is actually a problem that I had in a real standard, and there was one of these in about 3 pages of code. It gave me an error that I could not get rid of. My colleagues couldn't find it. I lost 3 days trying to find what the issue was. I nearly threw my laptop out of the window. It was
Terrible
hell.
situation.
Awful. I had nightmares about it at night. So,
The message is
no
hard
soft
returns.
returns.
Hard
Hard
returns all
returns
the way.
only.
Yes.
Exactly. Please, please, please. You just use the code style. You don't need to do anything else. Please be kind. And then, of course, we don't want to see any fancy colored, bold, italic, underlined text.
No.
We know this is a very bad thing and you should avoid it, but it's okay.
Saying it is enough.
Exactly.
Yeah. Let's just leave it like
I
that.
think we'll get the point.
Okay. Let's move on to tables.
Yes, tables.
Okay, so tables are great, can be super helpful, but if they're not laid out properly, they can also be really time consuming.
Exactly.
So I just see here we have what we were talking about before. We have some exclamation marks.
Yes.
I'm sorry, I'm used to a QWERTY keyboard, and I'm just gonna make that into do not
Exactly.
as well. But I think we're okay with the rest just
Well,
here.
we also have some pronouns in there as well. Now, this is
Oh,
something we
yeah.
see quite rarely, but we do see it.
This
And
one
we're
here.
not supposed to use pronouns. So, I, you, he, she, anything like that, don't put it in. We would redraft this to something else. In this case, we're just going to
We're
delete
just going
it.
to delete it.
It
Yeah.
doesn't,
Add
it's
any
okay.
personal.
Exactly.
Someone's, oh, and someone's just
Whoops.
having a rant. But see what I did there? I deleted it, but I also deleted the paragraph mark. So I'm just going to undo what I did there because that means that it gets rid of my heading style.
Exactly.
So I'm going to be careful I don't get the paragraph mark and do that.
Perfect. Exactly. So that is now correctly drafted.
Sometimes when you have figures in your document and your figure is split up into numerous smaller figures, all
Yes.
part of the whole, you can lay it out in a table,
Yes.
and this is often the best way to do it.
Exactly.
But the our point, important thing we want to show you here is that everything is included in a table, and this is not okay. So if I highlight the table, I can see the figures are in a table. That's fine. But also the
Yes.
key title, the key text, the figure heading, and also some extra text.
Yeah, it's a bit
That's a
crazy.
bit crazy. So not what we want.
Exactly. So if we have many of these, this is where we can spend a lot of time that we really don't need to spend. Very simple to fix, thankfully. So we just highlight the parts of the text that we don't want to be in a table. We go to layout across the top, and then on the far right-hand side, we've got this convert to text button. And it gives us the option to have paragraph marks or tabs. Usually it recommends the correct one. We just leave it. And there we go. It spits it as plain text, basically. And from there, we can go ahead and take care of fixing the key.
But our key, of course, does need to be in a little key table again.
Exactly. If you want to leave it like this because you don't know how to put it into a table, completely fine.
That is
Just
okay.
make sure it's styled correctly.
Yes.
Basic is just that we ask for the styling, pretty much.
Yeah.
So this now looks
That
okay.
looks okay.
We're happy
We've
with
got our
this.
M dash in the title, but we also have underneath a whole lot of text that's crossed out.
Yeah.
Oh, we don't know what to do with this.
Exactly, because
Do
we
you
are
want
not
it there
technical
or not?
editors, are we? We're not technically trained. We don't know what the content of this is supposed to be. We don't know what's correct or incorrect. So this to me suggests that it should maybe be deleted, but I could be very wrong. That's the thing. So in our case, we would write to you and we would say, what is this? What are we doing? What is this for? Do we delete it? The same thing if we have any portions of red text or things that are reading as notes from maybe the drafting procedure. Just do a pass of the text at the very end before you submit it and get rid of things like this. Just make sure it's clear because we are trusting you to be the experts of your content.
Yes.
We just make it look pretty and we provide XML and we apply R3 as well.
And our English language skills.
And our English language skills, but we can't talk for the technical content of the standard. In this case, we wrote to RTC and they said, you can delete
Oh,
it.
please delete that.
Very sorry to have left that in.
Okay, now we're up to tables again.
We are.
And we have this table, first table, table blah blah. The
Yes.
first thing that stands out to me with table blah blah is that we have a black header. This is
Yes.
not possible. Amy, can you please fix this for me?
I certainly can. And the reason this does not work is because XML doesn't like white text. It doesn't support it. So we're going to change that to automatic and then maybe show you in the table layout or table design it is. So we're going to highlight our whole header row and we are going to set it to no color at all. We don't want any
No
color in there.
colors.
This is how it should be. You can have gray backgrounds if you want. Just make sure it's black text, no white text. So this table is filled with blah blah because it's blah blah things that we don't like. And the next one is about the footnotes. So you'll notice footnote A is very small and is superscript. Footnote B is a little bigger, but it's still up there. So what is the difference
So
here?
I think it's because footnote B, if we go back up to our home tab, footnote B is not superscripts, but it is raised. Yeah.
Yes.
So if we go to that little arrow you see in your
Yep.
font, open that up, go into advanced, and then you can see that it's raised there. There's nothing per se wrong about that, but we can't have a mix in one table. So either all your footnote references and your footnotes need to be superscript or they need to be raised. One or the other, you
Yeah,
can't have a mix.
exactly. The reason for this is because XML is really cool. If I click this footnote in the XML, it takes me down to this footnote. But if these are different, it assumes that it doesn't exist. So think about that kind of thing when you're choosing, just as long as they are the same. Now, this table is also normative. Tables shall be laid out according to table one, which does mean that this reference
Oh, I
is
don't think
negative.
we saw that in our clause too, Amy.
We certainly didn't. So what we would do is we would pop this into our normative references, we'd add the title, and we'd tell you that we've done that as well. So now we can move on to our big long table, which is not big and long at all, but this is just to show you what happens. So we sometimes see long tables split like table one of one, table two of two. This doesn't really work. It increases the weight of your text. So very simply, what your editor will do is we will take that away. We'll check the footnote here to make sure it's the same as here. If it's different, we'll combine them all together. In our case, they're exactly the same, so I can go ahead and delete them. And then in our second table, we're going to delete the
The
title,
title.
delete the table header as well, because it's exactly the same. Oops. And then we're going to delete this, and hopefully we hit delete enough times.
Our table is joined together again.
Exactly, and it's
Yes.
beautiful. If you do have a table that splits across many different pages, highlight your table header row, go to layout, and on the far left side, you've got this
Right
handy
side.
dandy, on the right side, forgive me, you've got repeat header rows. And all that means is that this row on every page will be at the top of your table. Use that. It's really nice. So I think that's everything for our tables that we can
Okay.
mention.
Yep, now we're going to head into formulae.
Yes.
Formulae can also be very time consuming.
Yes.
So we've got a number of examples here for you. So the first one we have, it looks quite okay actually. The layout is good. We've got a formulae number on the side, number one. It's in the right position on the right with a nice big tab. But underneath where we have the explanation of the formula, we need to have that in a table. And I can also
What
see
is
that there's,
this?
I think we're going to zoom in. That is, it's another tab.
It's
See
a tab.
these sneaky tabs? Tabs we don't like so much. There's only a few
Exactly.
instances in documents that they work well.
Yes, exactly.
But this is not one of them.
No, but they can be useful. And a very quick tip that I will give you that I use on most of the documents that I have. If you have one tab here, it will consider this each separate portions of text. And what you can do is you can go to the Insert tab and you can go to Table. And right here, you have Insert Table and it treats it as two separate
I
cells.
really like that one.
I love that
Yes.
trick. And then we can hide our borders. And obviously, it will show us where the borders are, but this doesn't print, doesn't show up in the PDF. It is beautiful. That is quite a good trick for you to know. It's very useful, not just for drafting either. So this looks good now, I think.
Yes.
I guess we can go ahead and just give a quick edit of this, which I think looks okay. Maybe this is problematic. The CCMC editor converts them. We would change this to they are converted so that we don't put the emphasis on the who. But the main issue here, I believe, is this paragraph, paragraph A3. It should be clause.
Yes, let's change that.
We're going to edit that out. So now we are on to our finishing steps. So once the text is edited, the CCMC editor should contact. So again, maybe we remove this and we say the technical committee secretary
Should be
should
contacted
be
or
contacted.
is contacted.
Yeah, but this is all fine. We've got a lovely reference to our Annex B.
Oh, you better get rid of that
Yeah.
exclamation mark
Exactly. Yes, we are excited to finish, but not that excited.
though.
This is a
Okay,
perfect
ready? This is
list. It's
fine
very
then.
beautiful. Perfect.
Okay, so now we're going to move on to our annexes. Annexes are alphabetical,
Yes.
but importantly, they are only either one or two, one of two things:
Yes.
informative or normative. Here we've
Exactly.
got, I don't know, what have we got?
So here we've got a few examples of things we have seen people invent for their annexes over the years. The problem with this is we don't know if it's supposed to be normative or informative. We can take an educated guess, generic, fairly generic, probably informative. Technical, we mark technical changes, so
Probably normative.
publication, probably
Yep.
normative. Yep. Empirical, I have no clue at all. Anything else? No idea.
Leave us guessing.
So we can very simply, well, we can do one of two things. We can either write to you and wait for you to tell us. Usually we read the annex and see if there's any kind of offering, if there's any kind of hint of what it should be. In this case, there's not. We have this annex. If it was this informative annex, fairly obvious.
We would probably pop informative up there.
Exactly. However, we do have a shall right here, which leads me to believe it is normative. So we're going to pop
So.
normative in there. And then obviously, we don't want that bold. We want that not bold. So that is the labeling. So please only normative or informative, nothing else.
So the layout here looks quite good, I think.
It does. However, we have an A11 with no A12.
Oh, yes.
So we don't need that. If this wasn't a general title, we would just simply merge that together with this one, have a longer title, get rid of that. That is a lovely, simple edit. Worth noting as well, if you do provide us with figures, which is not obligatory for CENELEC texts, we do sometimes get the comment that JPEG, PNG, any other kind of figure does work with XML, but in CCMC, we only use TIFF. That's what works with our tools. So that's why we ask. So, regardless of anything else working, it's what we have
We need the
in-house.
TIFF files, please. Yes.
Exactly.
This
This
figure looks quite nice.
looks beautiful.
There's
Aha.
only just the, yes, the
Title that we're going to fix
little
real
up in
quick.
our M dash over there, like we
Exactly.
showed you
Oh,
before.
go away. There we go. Oh, symbol. There we go. And now we have some examples of formulae. So we've called these the good, the bad, and the ugly in the hopes that it will stick in your mind a little better. So if it's plain and simple, we call it the good. If you have A plus B equals C, you can leave it as plain text, type it with your keyboard, same thing, 1 plus 2 equals 3, something like that. Type it, reduces the weight, reduces the scope for us introducing errors or something slipping in there that shouldn't be. So this is beautiful. Styled as formula, got the tab, got the number. Perfect. But then we have something that looks good, but is actually the bad. So this is where the paragraph markers also come in handy because these two look exactly the
Yeah,
same.
you can't really see much difference.
Exactly. But this is all spaces, and this sometimes explodes off the page
Yeah.
in a crazy way. So we don't like this. So we would just simply pop a tab in there and then clean up any of the remaining spaces. And then we can clearly see it's not
It's
styled
not styled.
correctly either.
No,
So
no,
we
it
go ahead and do formula like that. There's no tab there, so obviously it didn't jump over. Voila. And then finally, we have the ugly. And this is the worst thing that you can do to your editor. So please do not do it. Everything in a table, it might seem tempting to lay these out in a table,
but
but
very time consuming.
yeah, and we can't even activate the text for
No,
XML if
so
these are
we have
here.
to, this is like one of the first things that we have to do. And
Exactly.
you can imagine if you have a lot of formulae all laid out in tables, that equals a lot of time.
Exactly. So thankfully, it is a simple fix, but just be aware it does take us a lot of time, especially if you have a very technical standard with hundreds of formulae in. If we have to do this for every single one, oof, it's a lot. It's not cool, so please do stress. But yeah, that's an overview of the formulae. It should be fairly simple.
Okay, so I think our Annex A is done. And so now we have our
Yes.
Annex B. We can see our Annex B is normative. I'll
Yes,
just
please.
make that unbold.
Yes.
But we have a not so nice figure example here.
Yes.
First of all, I can see that it's, well, the figure itself is not even there. So we're going to have to reinsert that figure.
Exactly. So this sometimes happens when you insert it and then the folder changes location or something like that. It's not a huge problem. We know it exists. It's nothing that you've done wrong. So simply what we're going to do is our lovely CENELEC TC provided us with some images. So we can insert them ourselves. So we're going to go to our place on the network. And we have our drawing folder.
Drawing folder, yes.
And we can see, oh, B1 isn't named properly. So we're going to take care of that. We're just going to call it B001.
Yes, simple is best when it comes to
Exactly.
naming figures. We
Something.
don't want any spaces or words or things like that.
Right, exactly. So once we've renamed it, we're going to go to insert. Hold your horses a little bit, click the arrow, and go to insert and link. That's important for the XML. And you can see it pops our image in lovely. And this is an important image we're going to zoom
Can
in on just
zoom
so that you
in.
can read, because this is what your editors are going to send to you with all of those notes that we've picked up from the editing of the text. So hopefully this is visible on your screen. But we basically just send you an email with something like drafting notes, drafting issues, points for drafting with your reference and the ETC information. As well, we'll either attach a zip file or the text itself if it's small enough,
Yep, I usually
something
attach the
like that.
text itself.
Yeah, with the marked up version. And then we just give you a brief overview of what's changed. I also send a text file to my TCs as well, just describing in more detail what the issue is as well. But this is something that you might see from your editors. We all have our different ways of writing things, so it won't be exactly like this. But just to give you an idea. So now we can go ahead. I think
Oh, we
I might
might.
need to correct that.
Figure title there,
Exactly.
again, adding in our M dash. And there we go. And now we're up to our final annex. We've
Exactly.
included this here just to, as an example, for
Yes.
if your document is harmonized, you're going to need to have this annex in here.
Yes.
We need you to populate this
Yes.
annex.
Absolutely.
Basically, where all the red text is, that's all the information that needs to go in.
Yeah, now we can check certain elements of this, like directive references and stuff like that, but we can't fill this out properly for you because we simply don't have that information. So we really do rely on you to fill this out for us. So do make sure you're firstly using the correct template for this. We do give you the generic Annex ZZ in the simple template, but there are other templates available for different sectors as well. So just make
Yeah.
sure you've got the correct one.
And if you don't need it, of course, you just delete it.
Yeah, exactly. But we've just left this in to show you. And now finally, our bibliography.
Looks terrible, by the
It really
way.
does. It looks horrible. So this is okay. You might want to split your references up. Maybe you've got some references that are actually in the document and then other references that you found for fun that you might think are interesting for
For
the end
background
reader. Yeah.
information.
This, however, is not okay. The following references shall be considered indispensable. This should really be close to. And a
Yes, if there's
bibliography.
something essential in there that it
Yeah.
needs to be referenced normatively in the body of your text and it needs to go in clause two, not in the
Exactly.
bibliography. We also never double up references.
No. We will always check if it's actually normative. For this, usually we can just copy paste all of these references out and then we can delete the table, or we can use our handy trick to convert to text. We can
So
delete
no
this.
tables. So
No
that was the
tables. No
no
tables.
tables for the bibliography.
Yeah, and also no lists like this. So I know we said we can't often control the automatic numbering, but here you kind of can, you have to. So we can just turn this into biblio entry and it shouldn't be in an automatic list like this. If you want them numbered, you can do so simply with square brackets, a little tab, that's another place we allow it, and then your numbering as well. But that is optional. If you don't want to do that, you don't have to. It's very simple. This really is how it should be laid out properly. Anything can go in here. If you found something useful or if something's been given for information only, then it goes into the bibliography. Nothing normative. So I believe
Okay,
our editing
I
is
think we've
completely
reached the
done.
end of the document.
Yes. So now we go all the way back to the top.
And we're going to do
We
the.
are going to, we clean the text, we get rid of all of our color tagging, and then we create our marked up version. So we go to the compare across the top. And this is a handy trick for you to know as well if you want to compare two versions of the text. This is what you can do. So we open up our folder. We take the text that you provided to us. So this is the raw unedited text. And this is our original document. And we compare it, obviously, with the text that we edited. And we open. We let this run a little bit. And you can see. It's got everything in there. Now, because we do run certain processes that help us out with styling and that kind of thing, and obviously sometimes we have to style things completely as well from scratch, it tracks all of those too. So if they're all in there, if it's overwhelming and you can't see anything, we're going to go to show markup and just uncheck this
Yeah,
formatting.
that will help a lot.
And you see all of our comments actually disappeared because all of the formatting that we did is now gone. So you can just see the changes that matter, basically. So we then save this, we call it the STM. That's STM for marked up. And we're not going to save this today because this is an example. The final thing that we do, or one of the final things that we do, is we update our table of contents. So for this, highlight the whole thing. We go to our references. On the far left, table of contents. And then down here, custom table of contents. And you get these. You want to click on options. And this gives us a list of every single style that is in the text.
Yeah, so these will already be filled in if you have a table of contents in there.
Yes.
But what we want to do is we just want to reset that.
Yeah.
So now they're all blank, and now we can
Yes.
go along and fill in what we actually need.
Exactly. So we want our annex and our annex Z. We want our biblio title because that's for our bibliography. And we can ignore all of this. We want our forward title.
Definitely want our forward title. We also want our introduction.
We do. Heading one, two, and three is already there. But if you have hundreds of heading three and hundreds of heading two and it looks messy, simply just delete. Just get rid. But we want our intro title, as Claire said. And that's really everything. There's nothing after intro title that you will need. So you can stop scrolling after that. Hit OK twice. And yes, we want to replace this table of
There we go.
contents.
That looks quite nice.
Exactly. Now, that is a useful skill for you to have. Because we do know that there are some problems with the table of contents, and we often have people panicking about it. There's no need to panic, it's okay.
Oh, Amy,
Yes,
we forgot something.
we certainly have. This is a CENELEC text, and for CENELEC texts, we always have to have the line numbers on there. In the layout tab, here we go. We just want this line numbers right here, and we want it to be continuous.
Because we want it on every page.
Exactly. Now, we prefer to do this at the very end instead of as you go because they can corrupt sometimes. So, just to avoid that, do it at the end, update it at the end.
Same with the table of contents. It's
Exactly.
you can do it earlier, but it's better to do it at the end,
Yep.
so then your page numbers will be correct.
Exactly. And you can see they're all the way through as well. So, the final thing to do is we prepare our PDF file. And we simply just pop it. It's not going to, it did take me to where I needed to be. Save it wherever it works. And that's going to work in the background. In the meantime, we'll draft up our email. We'll write to you. We'll handle the little things like our title pages. But then we are basically done. So this is it. We check our beautiful
Check our
PDF,
PDF.
make sure everything's okay, make sure we haven't missed anything. And then we either send to you to fix those problems. Or we upload straight to translation if there's nothing we need from you.
If there's nothing controversial in our email or anything we think,
Exactly.
oh, they might not be happy with that, or we're
Exactly.
unsure.
And as a rule, if there's no news from us at all, that is good news. It means your standard was beautiful
And
and
thank you.
perfect, and we didn't have to bother you, and we could just progress it on.
Yes.
But that is the end of our edit, at least. So we've just got a final slide for you. And obviously, we are sick of saying it. You're probably sick of hearing it, but use the CENELEC template, which is on the CENELEC boss, please.
Yes. Styling is super important and it
Yes.
will help everything to go more smoothly.
Yes, a good structure of your standard is indispensable, so make sure you're not doing something too crazy.
And make sure you check the IR3 internal regulations part three when you're drafting if you've got any queries.
Yes, and of course, if you're not sure, ask your friendly CCMC editor for help. It is what we are here for. We
Yes.
love helping you out. We love these webinars for engagement and that kind of thing.
And
So
feel free to call
reach out.
us too.
Yes,
Or email.
absolutely. Whatever helps you. So that is the end of our presentation. We're very sorry to have gone 15 minutes over, but we hope you still found it useful. So Els, our lovely moderator, has just popped a feedback poll up on your screen. So just take a few minutes to fill that out. It does help us
See
with
what we
future
can do better
webinars.
next time.
Yes.
And we're just going to take a look at the questions coming up as well.
Exactly. So we have one that says, is it allowed to use checkboxes or other fields for a form in the annexes from the development tools that Word offers? This isn't something we see so often, actually, checkboxes and things like that. Normally, if there's a form that people have used, it's usually just a flat text
Yeah, it's usually
kind of
just in like
thing.
an image file, I guess, of a form to give an
Yeah.
example.
Yeah, image file, or you can create it using a table as well. Maybe that's something we would have to test to see if it does give us problems, but
To be honest, I haven't had one recently
not.
enough to be able
Yeah.
to say, so we can get back to you on that.
Exactly. It's not so common, let's say. But we don't have any other questions that are open for the moment. So Els, if you'd like a final word to close us out, maybe while we wait for the
Yes,
questions.
Thank you, Amy and Claire. And thank you as well, Marlies, who has been answering all or almost all the questions in the background. So great. As promised to the attendees at the beginning, the webinar has been recorded. So you will receive the link to the recording later today. On this very last slide, you see the link as well to the upcoming webinars. And it's also the link to consult the past webinars. So if you are interested to hear and see it back again, you can do that via there. So thanks a lot, and hope to see you next time. Bye bye.